in the area of continental philosophy broadly, but with more focus on Marxian philosophy, ideology, as well as methodology, post-Marxian, you know, schools, post-structuralism. He also works, you know, in Foucault. He has quite a lot of, you know, writings on Foucault. Professor Madhu, in fact, is instrumental, I should say, in you know, revitalizing the philosophical deliberations in Malayalam language. I mean, Madhu, along with some of our friends, they have been very actively engaged in propagating, you know, philosophy through vernacular language, particularly in the context of Kerala in Malayalam. So yeah, the series of articles, you know, Madhu has published in prestigious, you know, Malayalam publications, literary publications, and he has also edited a few anthologies, one of which was published by Sahitya Academy, Kerala Sahitya Academy. The title in Malayalam is Jnanam Abhavam. If I take the liberty to translate it freely, I might say the negation or the absence that I am. Madhu may not agree with this, you know, shoddy translation, but something like that. Also, he has published, you know, in Malayalam other, you know, books like New Theories, Navasiddhantangal, which was again published by a very prestigious publisher, DZ Books. Madhu has also contributed, you know, to a very weighty anthology a few years back, edited an anthology which may be translated as Reading Marx, or Marx Readings, perhaps, which was a quite contemporary way of looking at Marxian philosophy. Apart from that, Madhu has also brought out a special, you know, volume focusing on Bodhi as part of Indian Philosophical Quarterly, IPQ, a special volume he has edited. He has published in various prestigious journals. And currently, Professor Madhu is head of the Department of Philosophy as well as a Dean of the School of Humanities at the University of Calicut. With this, and today, you know, as you all know, Madhu would be talking to us on Foucault, particularly focusing on the theme, you know, subject, body, and power. Now, this is a very, you know, a theme which has quite contemporary relevance given our current situations. I'm sure Madhu would be touching upon certain aspects of that also. So, with these few words, let me welcome you all, and special welcome to you, Professor Madhu. So, let me hand over now to the organizers, Vidya and other friends. So please feel free to proceed, Vidya.
So Vasudha will be moderating the lecture. Over to Vasudha.
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Professor Madhu, a very warm welcome to the lecture. I request you to decide how long you would take to speak and allot some time for question answers. I request everyone over here to put their mics on mute during the course of the lecture. Yeah, thank you. So over to you, Professor Madhu.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Koshi, for your good words. And very good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, I am. Clear, clear.
Yes, you are. Yes.
See, at the very outset, let me thank Professor Koshi Taragan and his colleagues, research scholars and others, for organizing such a lecture series, and also for giving me an opportunity to share some of my reflections on Foucault, especially on the notions, very key notions like subject, body, and power in Foucault's writings. And this is primarily a lecture on Foucault, and primarily designed for the students of philosophy. And the difficulty that I face here is that, see, discussing Foucault in a philosophical community would not be very easy. Like, you know, I would say that it is not easy in the sense that, see, Foucault, I don't consider Foucault as a philosopher, first of all. And Foucault himself would agree with me in this respect, because now he would say that he's not at all interested in doing philosophy, like, you know, the sense in which we understand philosophy, at least. Because yes, I know the very philosophical analysis of ideas or the conceptual kind of analysis. This exercise he was not at all interested in, but he was interested in some other, philosophically significant, but it's not philosophy as such. I would say that a kind of, not a conceptual analysis or analysis of ideas, but a kind of historical kind of, he would say that it's a history of ideas, his own terminology. This is a history of ideas that he is interested in. But whereas we students of philosophy are concerned, we are, going for some kind of conceptual kind of analysis, a rigorous kind of philosophical analysis of concepts, ideas, whereas Foucault is interested in the history of ideas. And for the same reason, a philosophical engagement with Foucault's writings would be a bit difficult, right? And in this lecture, one more thing that I wanted to add here is that as an introduction, that a history of ideas kind of thing. Of course, he is not a historian, even in the sense in which we understand history and in a strictly disciplinary sense. He would say that it is a history of ideas, not a kind of empirical history writing kind of thing. Whereas he would say that it is a kind of archaeological kind of inquiry. And archaeology would mean that it's a kind of, digging out the conditions of possibility of the ideas which we are talking about. A kind of, inquiry into the conditions of possibility of knowledge. That term is familiar to us, that conditions of possibility in the Kantian sense. But in Foucault, we would see a different kind of analysis, not a Kantian critique kind of thing. But he would say that the conditions of possibility of ideas, these conditions of possibility are a priori, but historical a priori, oxymoron kind of thing, as far as a philosophy student is concerned. How can the a priori be historical? He would say that there are some historical a priori conditions that make ideas possible. And he would be interested in a kind of archaeological kind of digging out the conditions of possibility of ideas. With these words, I would go to the topic of today's lecture, subject, body, and power. I'm taking these three key notions. Especially those who are familiar with Foucault's writings, these three terms play a very crucial role in Foucault's writings and Foucault's lectures and his interviews, throughout his intellectual career. Let me actually begin by clarifying these concepts or the clarifying the sense in which, Foucault has tried to use these concepts in his writings. Of course, all these notions are familiar to us as students of philosophy. We know what subject is, and we know at least, in some senses in which the notion of body is being used in philosophical literature. And of course, we are familiar with the notion of power, especially in political theory and other things. But Foucault has used these terms, these notions, not strictly in the sense in which we have been using them in theory and in philosophy especially. So let me begin with the notion of subject. And the notion of subject is, as you all know, is familiar to us. And we have been using the notion of subject in an epistemological sense as knower, a subject of knowledge, as opposed to the object of knowledge, which is known, or the object. Okay? So this term is familiar to us as far as philosophy students are concerned. We have been, doing a lot of philosophical exercises, in terms of or on the Cartesian notion of subject and epistemological notion of the notion of knowing, knowledge, knower. And also, the subject is known to us in a phenomenological sense, like the subject of experience. the one who feels, one who experiences, one who thinks. Okay, as in phenomenology, you know that it's a subject of intentionality kind of thing. That also is familiar to us. But it could be also consciousness, I or cogito, ego, even body in the Merleau-Pontian sense, body, subject, and other things. See, Foucault was actually uses this notion of subject radically in a different sense, maybe implying the sense of agency rather than the epistemological notion of subject. He especially in the paper which I have circulated, that subject and power. If you go through this paper, or if you closely read it, you know, we will realize that, you know, Foucault is not using the term subject strictly in an epistemological sense, but, you know, having a different sense. Mostly, I would say that using the notion of subject, implying the sense of agency. And this subject, as far as Foucault is concerned, is something which is activated only in the context of some relations. And perhaps the central concern of Foucault's writings is to see how this activation happens. You know, and he himself would say that, especially in the paper which I have just mentioned, the paper which was written in the last, towards the last, the second phase of his intellectual career, which I consider to be very important as far as this lecture is concerned. He himself would say that he has already explicitly mentioned in this paper that what I have been doing throughout my intellectual career, he says that, looking into different modes of objectification by means of which human beings have become subjects. So the central concern of his writings throughout his intellectual career, he himself would claim that, how subjects are being produced, or how human beings become subjects through various modes of objectification. And this statement is very important. I would say that as far as Foucault's writings, Foucault's thought, understanding Foucault's writings, is concerned, this particular statement is significant. And what I am trying to do in this lecture is to make sense of what exactly Foucault means by saying that a kind of his concern is to see to see how subjects are being produced. So it means that subject is something which is produced first of all. It is not, especially as we have discussed just a moment before, that not in the strictly epistemological sense, but subject as something which is produced, historically produced, and how this production happens, okay? How this particular activation of subject takes place. And he would say that, especially in the paper which I have mentioned now, he would say that subject is produced, first of all, it is a historical kind of entity, historically produced kind of thing, not something necessary or a priori kind of thing, but it is something which is produced, historically constituted as the effect of what he calls power. Okay, I'll come back to this problem, this question of power, at a later stage of this lecture. But the point here is that, as far as Foucault is concerned, subject, first of all, is to be understood as something which is historically produced, and it is through power that this activation of subject takes place. Or subject is the effect of the relation, what he calls power, or he would say that power produces subjects. And secondly, the second notion that we would be discussing here is the notion of body. And the notion of body is also familiar to us in various senses, like we know the historical, the Cartesian notion of body as extended kind of substance in as opposed to the thinking substance of I or Kujitu. And also, the notion of body is familiar to us in a phenomenological sense, as you know, in Husserl, Merleau-Ponty, and other phenomenological thinkers belonging to the phenomenological tradition, the lived body as the locus of intentionality and things like that. So, you know, but again, coming to Foucault, you know, you would see an entirely different, sense or entirely different way in which, you know, or entirely different kind of articulation of the notion of body in Foucault. See, he was using the notion of body not in the sense of extension or extended substance, also not in terms of intentionality, as a locus of intentionality or whatever. But, you know, as far as Foucault is concerned, body is to be primarily understood in terms of, you know, what he calls inscription. Okay, so as different from the extension model of Cartesian thinking, and also from the intentionality model of the phenomenological tradition, Foucault is trying to understand the phenomenon called body, or trying to use the term body in terms of inscription, you know, a term which is being used in a specific sense in Foucault's, most of Foucault's writings, you know, especially in Discipline and Punish and other writings, right? See, and he would say that body is a site of inscriptions. Okay, I would come to this point of inscription. But you know, what does it mean to say that body is a site of inscriptions? And he would say that it is body is always already a politically inscribed field. So understanding body in terms of inscription, you know, this is something which is, you know, very interesting in Foucault's, you know, understanding of body. See, and he would say that if body is something which is always already a politically or culturally inscribed field, then there is no pure body or biological, so-called biological body is unavailable. You know, it is something which the pure body, which is, you know, free from all kind of inscriptions, is a mythological kind of thing. It is not available at all as far as Foucault is concerned. See, now the point is, what does actually Foucault mean by this inscription? What is this business called inscription? See, inscription, Foucault tries to clarify this term, the use of this particular term in many of his writings. Like, you know, inscription is not, you know, there are two terms, like in and scription. Scription is a kind of writing, and inside, you know, it refers to some kind of interiority. And Foucault would say that inscription is not just writing on the surface of a body. Okay, of course, you know, inscription refers to some kind of writing, but, you know, the writing in the context of inscription is different from the way we use the term writing, that writing on some kind of surface. But here, in Foucauldian sense, you know, inscription is an activity, is a practice through which an inside is being carved out. Okay, a carving out of some kind of interiority takes place. That while writing on the body, you know, through writing on the body, some kind of interiority is being carved out, carving out of some kind of inside. So in is being produced, or it is something which is being, you know, carved out through the writing on the body. You know, so this is a peculiar sense in which Foucault tries to use the term inscription in his writings. Rather, you know, I would say that this inscription is a kind of performative kind of thing, that through inscription, body becomes something. Okay, so there is no body which is free from inscriptions, and body becomes something only through some kind of inscriptions. So body is an inscribed site of inscription as far as Foucault is concerned. See, for example, see a male, a body becomes a male body only when it is placed in a system of classification where it is being inscribed as male. So the maleness of body or femaleness or whatever, you know, should not be taken as the natural kind of essence of a body, but it is purely a cultural inscription. So See, it is precisely in this sense that Foucault says that there is nothing biological about body. You know, this is a radical, a kind of, you know, extreme kind of radical, you know, extreme kind of, you know, what you call constructionism or whatever. But I know it is a debate, question of debate, that whether Foucault uses, Foucault is a constructionist in an ontological sense or in an epistemology, available, whether he talks about the availability of the body, or, you know, whether he uses it in a ontological, radical, you know, extreme kind of ontological sense, that there is no body outside inscriptions. See, anyway, I know I'm not entering into that debate now. But the point here is that in Foucault's writings, that, you know, Foucault would say that the depth of the body, the so-called depth of the body, is a surface effect. You know, it is an effect, you know, which is being produced, which is being created by means of some kind of writing on the body. So it is through the inscriptions an insight is formed. Through the writings on the body, its depth is formed. Okay, depth is something which is being constituted through inscription on the surface of the body. See, it is on the basis of this point that we can connect Foucault's notion of subject to, it is through this, you know, that we will be able to, you know, make sense of the connection between the notion of body and the subject. Okay, that is subject, you know, etymologically, actually subject means that which is thrown inside. Okay, ejection, sub refers to some kind of inside or base or whatever. And something which is being ejected inside is a subject. Something which is being projected, something which is being thrown inside is a subject. And as far as Foucault is concerned, the internality of this body, okay, the subject, the internality of the body, is a product of inscriptions. You know, this is the way he tries to connect the notion of subject and the notion of body. So, again, power is the mechanism. Foucault would say that power is a mechanism through which the subject is being carved out from the body. So, the notion of power becomes significant again, you know, in understanding both the notion of subject and the notion of body in Foucault. So Foucault's use of the term power has to be, you know, we need to make it clear that in what sense that he uses the term power. It is through power as a mechanism of power, it is through the mechanism of power that a subject is being produced or subject is being carved out from the body. So how does it actually take place? I know this is the whole point that we, you know, want to, you know, make clear, you know, as far as understanding Foucault's writings is concerned. And see, what does Foucault mean by saying that it is power produces subjects? And what does he mean by saying that power is a mechanism through which the subject is being carved out from the body? See, coming to the notion of power, and power is, as I have mentioned earlier, that power is also a familiar notion to us, that we also use the term power. We use the term power mostly in a very clear sense, that, you know, it is something which is, you know, in political theory and sociological or social theory and other areas of inquiry, that, you know, the notion of power is clear to us, that at least, you know, in the sense in which it is being associated with many other terms like oppression, domination, or subjugation. And is it the case that Foucault uses the term power in the same sense in which it is, you know, you are familiar with in various areas of various domains of our inquiries? Foucault, you know, I would say that uses the notion of power in a radically different sense. His question, you know, I would say that the difference is not actually to be understood, not in terms of the answer that Foucault gives to the question, what is power? But, you know, he himself makes it very clear in his art, especially in the paper, that Subject and Power, that now he is actually not interested in giving an answer to the age-old question, what is power? The what question is not his concern. You know, he makes it very explicitly clear that No, he is not at all interested in the what question with regard to the power. What is power? Okay, this is not his question at all. Because I know he would say that that question itself is misleading. That if you ask the question, what is power, it gives you an impression that there is something called power over there, which can be defined, you know, something, some kind of substance. Power is there, you know, out there, which can be defined objectively or otherwise. That, you know, there is some kind of substance, some kind of a thing, okay? Power as a thing or even a capacity of the body. You know, Foucault would never, be trying to give an answer to the question, what is power? Whereas his question is a different kind of question, that he would say that how, instead of asking the question, what is power, let us ask a different question, that how power is being exercised. So his question is a how question, not a what question. Okay, maybe philosophers are interested in what question, like, you know, in maybe in sociology or social theory, and even in political theory, people are more interested in the what question, how to understand the phenomenon called power. Whereas in Foucault's writings, he would say a different kind of, you know, posing of the question of power, that he would say that there is nothing called power, first of all. You know, we should be clear about that. There is nothing called power as a substance or a thing or a capacity of the body, you know, that we can define. You know, so there is no question of defining power. There is no question of asking the question, what is power in as far as Foucault is concerned. But his strategy would be a different kind of strategy, that he would say that instead of this big question that what is power, let us, you know, ask a different question, that how power is being exercised. The how question is important. Now, and again, Foucault would say that, see, power, I know, is nothing, or power is nothing but how it is being exercised. So there is no power apart from the ways in which it is being exercised. So this is purely a kind of performative kind of thing, that, you know, apart from the performances or some various kinds of exercises, that there is no power. You cannot find something called power. You know, it is not available for your definition or theoretical kind of understanding or whatever. But, you know, you can also only see how power is being exercised, how the various ways in which power is being exercised. See, this, again, I know I'm referring to the same paper written by Foucault in the, you know, by the title Subject and Power. And see, another point that he wanted to, you know, make clear is that power exists only in a performative mode. Okay, there is no existence of power apart from different ways in which it is being exercised. And number two, power exists only in the context of some kind of relations. So power is a relational kind of notion. That if there are, you know, some kind of relations that Foucault talked about, I'll come to that point later on. That see, power is something that exists only in the context of some relations, or only when it is exercised in the context of some kind of relations. So it is in this sense that he would say that it is purely, you know, a kind of performative. It exists in a performative mode. Now, from the question, what is power, you are going to a different kind of area, the different kind of concern, that how power is being exercised, first of all. And if power is something which exists only in the context of some kind of relations, then you are actually looking into the relations, not power. Okay? So your concern here is, what is a relation of power? Instead of, you know, what is power, how do we, you know, identify a relation as a relation of power? Okay. Foucault would say that any relation is not a kind of relation of power. So, for example, see, if I push something, you know, or put pressure on something and it moves, you know, apparently there is some kind of power, you know, implicated, or some kind of power which is involved in this kind of activity, that I'm pushing something and it is moving back, or putting pressure on something and you know, it moves back. So apparently there is something called power, but Foucault would say that the relation between the subject and object here, the subject who pushes and the object which is being pushed, Now, in this relation, you know, Foucault's, as far as Foucault is concerned, the relation between the subject and object is not a power relation, maybe a physical force or something like that. You know, force is being exercised on it, but not power. Power has to be, in this sense, as far as Foucault is concerned, has to be differentiated, fundamentally differentiated from force or physical kind of force. So any relation between A and B cannot be identified as a relation of power. So what are the conditions that enable us to, you know, identify a relation as a relation of power? You know, this is a question that, you know, Foucault wanted to explore, that how do we actually identify a particular relation between A and B as a relation of power? Or what are the conditions that enable us to identify a relation between A and B, you know, as a relation of power? And Foucault would say that this is the microphysics of power, a kind of inquiry which he himself terms at as the microphysics of power. See, now, you know, let us, you know, try to take up the question of identifying the conditions for, you know, the conditions for identifying a relation as a relation of power. See, or to put it in a different manner, Foucault would say that this microphysics of power, as far as Foucault is concerned, is all about the minimal conditions which enable us to say that, you know, there is power. Okay. To say that power exists in a relation, in a particular relation, what are the minimal conditions that enable us to say that there exists power, there is power in a relation between A and B? So this inquiry, you know, as I have already pointed out, it is a microphysics of power. Foucault's claim is that when, you know, this is very important as far as Foucault's understanding of power is concerned, that Foucault would say that when two things are related, okay, for example, A and B, okay, when two things are related in such a manner that the action of A, okay, acts on the action of B. Suppose, imagine a situation where there are two things like A and B. A acts in such a manner that the action of A acts on the action of B. Then Foucault would say that, you know, there is power. So power is something, you know, which can be identified only in a relation where action of one acts on the action of another. Okay, action of A acts on the action of B. Or Foucault, you know, would say that power is nothing but acting on the action of the other. You know, this is a different, I would say that is a different way of understanding the notion of power, which, you know, the notion of power is familiar to us, as I have pointed out earlier, that it is something which is associated with many other concepts like domination or oppression or subjugation and some kind of violence and other things. But Foucault's, you know, in Foucault's conceptual, you know, kind of, you know, geography, this has to be something. This is something which has to be differentiated from all other Marxist or psychoanalytic or whatever, you know, other notions, the perceived notion of power and other things. Now, Foucault's notion of power has to be understood primarily in a different way. That Foucault would say that it actually refers to a relation where an action acts on the action of the other. So power, okay, has to be understood as an action on the action of the other. What does it actually mean? How do we make sense of this, you know, claim that Foucault put forward, especially in his later writings, especially in this paper, Power and Subject? See, what does it mean to say that power acts? Power is an action on the action. Action on the action of the other. It is not an action on the object. You know, I am acting on the object, on some kind of physical object. This is not power. You know, maybe it's a force or whatever, but acting on the action of the other is power. So whenever there is power, there has to be a relation where action acts on the action of the other. Perhaps this is the most, as I have pointed out earlier, that is, this is the most important point as far as Foucault's notion of power is concerned, and also, you know, Foucault's later genealogical, so-called genealogical period of Foucault's writings, you know, is concerned. See, and I'll try to, try to make or, to clarify this kind of, what you call slightly, mysterious kind of, argument or claim that power is acting, action on the action of the other. See, imagine a situation that A and B, there are two individuals or whatever, two individuals here, A and B, and A and B are related. Okay, there is a relation established between A and B, and this relation is of such a nature that A or B acts on the action of the other. Okay, then Foucault would say that there is a relation of power here. See, the question here is that, see, why did B, if the case is like this, that A is acting on the action of B, then why did B choose to respond to the action of A when there were many other options? If B is a machine, A acts and B responds to this, some kind of intelligent machine, whatever, computer or whatever, robot or whatever, that you speak to a computer, there is an interaction between a computer and a human being. For suppose, imagine a situation where I give some kind of commands, I act in a particular manner, and the machine responds to these actions. Okay, see, is this a relation of power? Okay, or is it the case that the machine does not have any other options but to respond to my action? See, why did B choose to respond to the action of B when there were many other options? Like, for example, say B has an option not to respond to A. Okay. See, Foucault's point is that, B responded to the action of A means A acted on the action of B. Why? Okay. It means that Foucault's point is that, it influenced the action of B in such a manner that the other options are being suspended. So B has an option not to respond to the action of A. Okay. So this particular response of B, is not to be understood, or it's not to be understood in terms of power, because there is no other option. It acts in a mechanical manner. Okay. But if this is the case that, B has many other options, an option not to respond to the action of A, but still it, suspends all the other options and responds to the action of A, then, there is power here. See, it means that there has to be some kind of either or, some kind of choice on the part of B. Otherwise, it cannot be called as a relation of power. If B has no other options, if B has no choice at all, no either or kind of, situation, then the relation between A and B, the situation of interaction between A and B cannot be regarded as a field of power, a situation of power. So for identifying a relation between something, two individuals, as a relation of power, it has to be, the precondition for calling, a relation between A and B as relation of power is this, that there should be two subjects, first of all. So power is possible only between two subjects. There has to be some kind of, interaction between two subjects, then only you can call it as relation of power. See, and not only that, Foucault's a point which is being widely, maybe widely misunderstood by various, even by various scholars, that Foucault would say that power is not something which is opposite to freedom, whereas power implies freedom. See, what does it mean? Again, this is a very interesting point as far as Foucault's concept of power is concerned. See, freedom has to be taken as the condition of possibility of power. It is not an opposite, you know. It is not, you know, the case that power is opposed to freedom, whereas power presupposes freedom. What does it mean? Freedom means what? Here, I know it is clear that freedom means there has to be a, some kind of either-or situation, some kind of choice has to be there. If B is not having any other choice but to respond to the action of A, then the relation between the A and B is not a relation of power. B, you know, irrespective of the fact that there are other choices, other kind of options, that it responds to the action of A, then, you know, there is an influence. The action of A influenced the action of B. Then only you can, you know, we may say that the relation between A and B is a relation of power. See, this is a point which, you know, maybe, you know, we need to elaborate more on this point. I would come back, try to come back in this idea, to this idea. After discussing some more points with regard to the notion of power. See, let us try to explore some of the crucial implications of the notion of power as action on the action of the other. Number one, I would say that, see, if power is an action on the action of the other, then Foucault's point is that power has to be understood as something everywhere. It is something everywhere. Okay, it is everywhere in a social field. Okay, any kind of interaction between human beings, any kind of interaction between individuals, okay, has to be understood as a relation of power. Because in any relation between two individuals, okay, you know, there is a kind of, you know, what you call a situation where the action of one acts on the action of the other. So Foucault's claim is that power is everywhere, or in every social relation there is a kind of, you know, what you call interaction, in the sense that there is a kind of face-to-face kind of, you know, interaction, that, you know, there is in every social field, you know, if you put it like this, that in every social field there is a kind of distribution of bodies in such a manner that the action of each acts on the action of the other. See, there cannot be a society, again, Foucault's claim, you know, which is you know, widely being debated in many other circles, like, you know, in political theory and all, that he would say that there cannot be any society without relations of power. There cannot be any society without power. Okay, you cannot just imagine a society without power, because society means what? Society means there has to be some kind of interaction between some kind of face-to-face, like, you know, acting on the action possibility. Sorry, there's a situation of acting on the action of the other. So there cannot be any society, as far as Foucault is concerned, without power. Okay, so a society without power would be a kind of, you know, a kind of imagination. But, you know, and as far as Foucault is concerned, this is something which is impossible if you understand the notion of power as acting on the action of the other. And again, power comes from everywhere. You know, it should not be understood as necessarily coming from the upper strata of the society, like, you know, from the upper class or upper, as in the Marxist or some other kind of, you know, theories, that you would find a kind of vertical model of power. But as far as Foucault is concerned, it has to be understood as something which is horizontal. There is a horizontality in the relation of power, that it comes from everywhere. In every institution, Foucault would say that every institution, there is power, in the sense that without power, there is no institution as such. Okay? So the question here is a second and a point that we have to, you know, seriously look into is this, that, you know, the point with regard to the notion of institution. See, what does it mean to say that every institution is, you know, implies power, or there is a relation of power in every institution? That And first of all, we have to be clear about the notion of institution. What does Foucault mean by institution? So institution is a regularized pattern of interactions between A and B, between subjects, okay, between human beings, okay. A pattern, interactions which are, you know, regularized in a particular manner, that there is a, if there is a regularized pattern of interactions between different bodies distributed in a social field, then there is an institution. So institution here, you know, means there is a distribution of different bodies, and these bodies are being, you know, everybody acts, you know, on the action of the other, or is the action of everybody is being acted upon by the action of the other. So there is a kind of, you know, a field where bodies are distributed in such a manner that one body acts on the action of one body acts on the action of the other. See, for example, see, take family. Different members of the family, okay? We know that, you know, different members of a family are that different bodies of that particular institution called family are organized in such a manner that each, you know, acts on the action of the other. So family is a power, a field of power relations. So every institution, as far as, you know, Foucault is concerned, is to be understood as a field of relations of power. And for example, see, consider an educational institution. A classroom, for example. Okay, a classroom. We know that a classroom means what? I know there are different bodies are being distributed, and there is a regularized pattern of interaction between these bodies, like teacher and the student. Okay, and when a teacher enters into the classroom, I know all the students or different bodies distributed over there turn their face towards the teacher, and I know before that moment, I know that field is a field of multiple kind of possibilities, that people have been doing so many things like walking, dancing, or singing, or running. But at the very moment of another body or the teacher entering into this classroom, that field of possibilities, you know, is getting structured in a particular manner. Okay, suddenly the event of the body of the teacher entering into this classroom structures the, you know, the field of possibilities. Field of possibilities is getting structured, you know, by this, you know. So what does it mean? The action of a particular body acts on the action of many others. Like, you know, it is structuring a field of possibilities. So power, as far as Foucault is concerned, necessarily is to be understood in terms of an institution. And the institution is, you know, a structured field of possibilities, or it means that, okay, power is exercised, okay, you know, look at the many other institutions, like, you know, so we, you know, if you look at any other institution like this, let's see, power is actually being exercised in this institution through this act of structuring a field of possibilities, okay. So this is point number one. The first point that we have discussed is that power is to be understood as something which is everywhere in the sense that it comes from everywhere, and it is, there is no society, there is no social field, there is no interaction without power, okay. And the second point is that, see, it has to be understood necessarily in terms of an institution which is a structured field of possibilities, and power is being exercised by structuring a field of possibilities. This is point number two. And number three, again, see, if power is an action, is action on the action of the other, and as we have seen earlier, that it is not to be understood as something which is opposed to freedom. It presupposes freedom. And I know it doesn't make any sense to say that, you know, there is power in a field where a body has no option but to get acted upon by the other. So power is possible only in a field of possibilities. A field of possibilities means, or a field of possibilities implies the possibility of resistance. Okay. See, I know, take the example that we have discussed earlier, that you know, I'm pushing something and the body is moving back. Okay, I'm putting some kind of pressure on an object, a thing. You know, in Foucault's terminology, this is not power. This is something different from power than physical force or whatever. Why? Because Foucault would say that there is no resistance on the part of B. Okay, so to identify a relation as a relation of power, then both the agents implicated in this particular field are capable of resisting something. Okay, so there is no power without resistance. Power actually implies resistance. Again, these are not two opposite terms. Actually, power is exercised only on the condition of resistance, in the sense that our power can be, power is something which can be exercised only on the resisting bodies. Okay. You know, these are, you know, this issue, of course, obviously, Foucault, you know, discussing all these points which we have mentioned now, that you know, the field of possibilities, field of multiple institution as a field of structured field of possibilities, or the freedom as something which presupposes, sorry, power is something which presupposes freedom, or freedom is a condition for possibility, condition of possibility of power. And this point that there is resistance in every power relation, there is resistance, because without resistance, there is no power. Power is something which can be exercised on resisting bodies. All these are connected. You know, we know that, you know, if you closely, you know, observe, you know, the implications of all these notions, these concepts are, you know, this, all these points are connect, well connected. See, another point is that, see, again, if power is an action on the action of the other, okay, then power has to be understood not necessarily as repressive, but, you know, Foucault would say that it is enabling. Okay, power has to be understood as something which enables you to do something, you know, not as something necessarily repressive, okay, but as something which enables, you know, in Malayalam, we actually, you know, use the term adhigaram to refer to the English term power. But see, shakti, another term which is a Sanskrit, you know, which is having a, etymologically it means that there is some kind of enabling, like shakyam is enabling. So maybe shakti is a proper word, proper term to refer to the sense in which Foucault uses the term power, that it is not oppression, it is not something oppressive, but enabling. Okay, doing something, it enables a body to act in a particular manner, or it enables a body to act. Okay, this enabling, okay, this element of, you know, this element by means of which, or this kind of, you know, what you call capacity of, you know, enabling, sorry, you know, a relation where a body is being enabled to do something, you know, power actually refers to this. So power, you know, if we understand power as an action on the action of the other, then it has to be understood as, okay, not necessarily repressive, but as something enabling. See, a body, okay, Foucault would say that is enabled, okay, when it is placed, you know, in a field of relations of power. And being placed in a field of relations of power means it is inscribed. So going back to the point that we have discussed, you know, in the first part of my lecture, that, you know, inscription, okay, that, see, a body being placed in a relation of power means it is inscribed in a particular manner, and this inscriptions actually enable the body to act. So it is inscribed or being invested with power. Foucault would say that, you know, a power is being invested on the body if the body is being placed in a relation of power. So it means that some sort of interiority, a kind of subject refers to the interiority, that, you know, ejected inside, thrown inside, that subject is being carved out, okay, through this scription, that You know, it means that, you know, when the body is being placed in a relation of power, a field of relations of power, then it is enabled to act. Means, okay, some kind of the inscriptions are being, or some kind of, you know, what you call, body is being inscribed in a particular manner, or it is being, you know, invested with power, and because of this investment, that it is enabled to act. So, a kind of, you know, what you call interiority is being carved out from the body. So it is in this sense that Foucault says power actually, you know, produces subject. You know, power is something which actually has to be understood as, you know, producing, okay, the subject, the subjectivity. The inside is being formed through the outer scriptions on the body, the scriptions on the surface of the body. You know, as we have, you know, pointed out earlier, that it is a kind of performative kind of act, that the depth of the body is being, you know, created through the scriptions on the surface of the body. See, Foucault, you know, it is precisely that this is what, you know, happens as far as Foucault is concerned in disciplinary power, that, you know, a term which is, you know, very important in the context of Foucault's writings, that discipline and punish and all these things, that, you know, he would say that disciplining is a strategy of power through which a body is being inscribed and enabled to act. And he would say that the modern power, and I'm not entering into that debate now, that point now, but the point here is that historically speaking, he would, you know, look at the modern phenomenon called modern power, the phenomenon called modern power, which is has to be understood in terms of disciplining, you know, disciplining as a mechanism, as a practice through which a body is being, you know, inscribed in a particular manner, you know, in such a manner that it acts, okay, in a desired manner. So, see, in the modern era, okay, in Foucault's point, that power operates through bodies, or it is invested, power is invested directly on the bodies at a very biological level, you know, and this is what he means by biopower, and a point which I am not, you know, entering into at this, you know, in this lecture, I have not planned to, you know, move into that aspect of Foucault. So what my interest in this lecture was, okay, I would just conclude this by just summarizing what I have tried to, you know, discuss in this lecture, that see, all that I wanted to do in this lecture is to understand Foucault's claim, especially in this paper, Subject and Power, that his aim has been throughout his intellectual career was to create the history of subject. Okay, and he himself said it is a concern is to create the history of subject, particularly by making, how human beings have become subjects, how subject is historically something which is historically produced. Okay, see, I know the aim here is that how to philosophically make sense of this kind of, you know, idea that, you know, so to understand or making sense of Foucault's claim that, it is the human beings have become subjects through various modes of objectification, that we need to actually, philosophically speaking, we actually need to, you know, to have a clear idea of how Foucault connects these three, you know, loaded terms like subject, body, and power. And if you read Foucault's writings, you would not find any kind of, you know, what you call, you know, discussion or philosophical analysis of these notions. But see, as far as a student of philosophy is concerned, this is something which is, you know, maybe it is our, you know, headache, that, you know, how to make sense of the notions, the ideas, the concepts which are being used by a thinker. But to understand, try to make sense of or philosophically make sense of, you know, Foucault's project. I think that we need to have some kind of strategy to conceptually analyze and connect different notions which are being used by I think and Foucault. I would say that, you know, as far as a student of philosophy is concerned, this connection between these notions, like subject, body, and power, you know, this is something which is very important. And I was actually trying to, you know, at least, you know, in a very limited sense, I was trying to make sense, or philosophically making sense of the connection between these two notions. Sorry, three notions in Foucault's writings. Thank you for your patient listening. And I think we can have a discussion on the points which I have tried to discuss now. Over to you, Koshi.
Thanks a lot, Professor Madhu. It was quite interesting the way you brought these three notions, subject, body, and power. And also, I must say, you also brought the notion of institution, which is also crucial. So in that context, you know, the lecture in a way gave a philosophical orientation to otherwise, you know, such a broad canvas, which, you know, Foucault sometimes employs, as many students of philosophy, you know, gets this, you know, impatient, and they have a kind of impatience with reading Foucault, and not precisely for this kind of you know, philosophical anxieties that we encounter while reading Foucault. So let me request Ms. Vasudha to conduct the question discussion session. Vasudha, please monitor. Yeah.
Yes, sir, I'm here. Please post your questions on the chat box, and Vidya will be coordinating the questions. You can also raise your hand so that if you want to, you can ask your questions yourself. Yeah. Vidya?
Yes. Please post your questions in the chat box. We'll take them up one by one. If you would like to ask them yourself, please raise your hand. You can raise your hand. There's a raise hand button at the bottom of your screen. Srijit, would you like to ask the question?
Sure. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Madhu sir, for that wonderful lecture. I had gone through partially the reading material that you had distributed, and I realized how tough, how difficult it can be to understand the details of Foucault's thinking. But your lecture made it very easy, and a lot of the ideas are comparatively clearer now. It was very accessible. Thank you very much. So the first question, sir, I have actually one question and one sort of comment to check whether I understood some of the ideas properly. So the first question, sir, is that your comment that the idea of power in Foucault, if you were to understand the notion in Malayalam or Sanskrit as Shakti, I was thinking that, suppose I push a glass on the table and it moves. The way in which we understand the word Shakti in Malayalam, and probably also in Sanskrit, we would say that some kind of Shakti is involved there. But the way in which Foucault understand it, it's not a case of power. Power is not involved there. The way you articulate.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was thinking whether it is an apt word there. So that's the first question. Only if there is time, I'll
get your comment. Question actually, Srijit, I didn't get your question. Please could you repeat it?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, my question was, sir, you said the word power can be understood as the word Shakti, as we understand it in Malayalam or in Sanskrit.
Yeah.
So I was thinking, suppose, consider the case where we push a glass.
Which yeah, that kept. I got. That I got.
Okay. So I was thinking that in the case where we push a glass on top of a table, Foucault would say that power is not involved there. That's only a force, not power, as you mentioned.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
So I was wondering whether the word Shakti therefore is an appropriate word to use to refer to the way in which Foucault used the word power.
Yeah. Okay. Then to your observation part.
Your
please.
No, sir, not really observation. I'll just say what I understood, just to check whether I'm understanding it properly. Because I find it a little difficult to understand, and also I understand that Foucault's ideas are extremely complex, and you made it a lot accessible for us today. So one thing you said that there is a power. If suppose I have power on somebody else, if an action of mine has some kind of an influence on their action.
Yeah.
Okay. So then you said that power is everywhere. It's all pervasive. It's present everywhere.
Yeah. Right. In a social field.
Right. In a social field. Okay. Yeah. So I was thinking, but I can imagine a scenario where that suppose I basically you're saying all interactions are therefore necessarily power is involved in all interactions.
Yeah.
Right. So I was thinking, suppose I had an interaction with Professor Koshy only once in my entire lifetime, which is not true, but suppose that is the case. And suppose he said something to me and I take it to be an action, and that had no influence on my action. So therefore, one can say, therefore, power did not exist in that interaction. But then, of course, you also say that even resistance is part of power. So you might say that no, that did not have an influence on your action because you resisted to what Professor Koshy said. And that's why it did not have any influence on your action as such. So since resistance is also part and parcel of power, power is there. So is that what you're saying? I'm just trying to understand. Did I get your idea correctly?
Yeah. Thank you for your question, and also for your comments on the way I try to make sense of Foucault's notion of power. Actually, I was using the term Shakti. I'm not very sure about the etymological. I'm not an expert in Sanskrit, but etymologically speaking, not in the common sensical, or we use the term Shakti also in different senses, like in pushing something, some glass or something on the, so there is Shakti in it. Okay, I have some kind of Shakti too. See, but again, looking into the etymological sense in which the term is being used, there is a Shakya means enabling, enabling kind of thing. It is not necessarily a kind of physical force or something, applying a physical force on something. See, maybe that term is not appropriate kind of for Foucault's term of power. But the sense here is clear that, see, there has to be a distinction between physical force and power. Okay, physical force means, applying some kind of pressure on something means there is no, the B, on which I'm, applying the force, okay, does not have any other option, okay, there is no either or there, okay, or there is no freedom there, okay. Even Foucault would say that, even slavery cannot be taken as a relation of power. There is no power in the strict sense, Foucault would say that there is no strict sense, there is no power in a system of slavery, because slave is a property, okay. That if slave is being understood as your property, then the relation between the master and the slave is almost like a subject-object kind of relation. There is no subject-subject relation there. So to identify a relation as a relation of power, this has to be, the freedom has to be taken as a condition of possibility of power. Because if B has no other option but to respond, okay, in a particular manner, but to move back, okay, then this is force. But the thing is that, see, B should have an option not to respond to me, first of all. Okay? Some kind of either or should be presupposed. Otherwise, does it make any sense to say that there is power in a relation between these two individuals? So freedom has to be taken as a kind of what you call condition of possibility of power. So in the relation that you the situation that you have tried to explain, that to describe, that you know, I am pushing something, you know, a glass of water, and you cannot say that, you know, you would agree with me that there is no resistance on the part of the object which is being pushed. Okay, it you know, there is, so it, you know, there is no choice on the part of B. Okay, so in the strict Foucauldian sense of you know, the notion of power, there is no power in this relation. So power is can be, you know, observed only in the situation where both A and B, okay, are free, in the sense that, you know, there has to be a kind of, you know, other options are being suspended. Okay, the option of not responding to A is being suspended. And you know, for example, see, of course, in Foucault, the relation of communication has to be understood in a different sense, not necessarily as a power relation. That is a different point altogether. But I am not, you know, for the time being. For example, see, I am speaking to you, and you are listening to me. Okay, so there is a relation established between myself and the listener. Okay, you are listening to me, or there are many bodies distributed here in this context. Okay, some 62 bodies are here. Okay, and 62 bodies are having many kind of possibilities. Like, you know, you can either listen to me, you can go out of, you know, you can leave the classroom, you can do something else, you can dance, you can sing. You know, there are many other possibilities. But you know, this field of possibilities is being structured in such a manner that the moment I talk, you turn your face towards me. Okay, so there is a kind of this turning of your face towards, you know, the speaker, means that, you know, there is a kind of relation of power established between myself and the other. Okay, because you have many other options, but you know, you have suspended all other options and tried to respond to me, you know. So the very relation between my face and your face, you know, there is a kind of power, a kind of, you know, power is being, you know, I think, do you get me? Okay, the point that so power, you know, Foucault would say that is exercised by structuring a field of possibilities. Okay, so this is what he means when he says that, see, power implies resistance. Power is something which can be exercised only on a resisting body. Otherwise, it's not power. Okay. If there is no resistance on the part of B, then, you know, there is no power in the relation between B, A and B. Maybe I'm not very clear about the, you know, the term which I have used, or the Sanskrit or the Malayalam term Shakti, but more, you know, it conveys the meaning, at least taking the etymological kind of Shakya is, you know, when you take this particular aspect or etymological sense into account, so it would be more appropriate to thank you
Srijit for asking the question. Thank you, sir. We'll take a couple of questions from the chat box. Santosh Kumar has asked, how is the concept of sexuality related to all these?
Concept of sexuality you are talking about?
Right? Yes, that's the question.
Yeah. See, I know, actually I did not want to go into the various aspects of, you know, various things, like not only sexuality. I know Foucault has discussed many other things like madness or discipline and medicine, okay? Of course, sexuality in the last three volumes on sexuality. But the point here is that sexuality, one of the arguments that Foucault put forward is that there is nothing called, you know, it has to be understood as something, you know, as part of the inscriptions, that sexuality, there is nothing biological about sexuality. You know, he would say that it has to be understood as something in terms of, you know, inscriptions, that a body becomes something, a male or, you know, some kind of, you know, this thing. I know, as I pointed out the first part of my lecture, that there is nothing natural about that. You know, It is only when your body is placed in the context of some relations where it is being classified as male or female or whatever, means, you know, it is inscribed in a particular manner that it is enabled to act in a particular manner. So it is within this classification that, you know, a body becomes male or female or whatever. So the age-old kind of, you know, within the history of thinking that, you know, we are familiar with the distinction between gender and sex, okay, and many other things. Gender is cultural and sex is something biological. So Foucault is actually, you know, attacking the very distinction between sex and gender. That sex itself is something cultural. There is nothing biological about it. Okay, it is a part of a kind of discursive kind of construct as far as Foucault's terminology is concerned. So I have not really wanted to go on into the various aspects of Foucault's thinking, but I was trying to look into the logic, okay, of some kind of, you know, making sense of how he makes use of different notions, like, you know, which are philosophically loaded, like subject, body, and power. That's all for that question.
Thank you, sir. The next question is by C.K. Raju. He asks, when you say that power is an enabler, is this enablement at the cost of freedom of the other who is related?
Could you repeat it? I didn't get you properly.
When you say that power is an enabler, is this enablement at the cost of freedom of the other who is related?
Not exactly in the at the cost of the other, but see, the whole point is that, see, without freedom, I know, does it make any sense to say that, you know, you are, you know, influencing the action of the other, okay, in a situation where the other has no other option but to respond to you? So if this is the case, freedom has to be understood as a condition of possibility of power. It is already implied in the, so there is no power without freedom. You know, this is, maybe this is the sense in which Foucault or makes this statement that power implies freedom.
All right, we go on to the next question by Anselm. How does Foucault reconcile the social or cultural construction of subject, or subject as an effect and possibility of subject's freedom?
Could you repeat the question now?
Yes. How does Foucault reconcile the social or cultural construction of subject, or subject as an effect and possibility of subject's freedom?
Of the subject?
Of subject's freedom.
Subject's freedom. Right?
Yes, sir.
Still, it is not clear to me because
Madhu, the question is posed is this the either or one effect, you know, subject as an effect, and the other subject as freedom. How do you reconcile that?
Okay, right. Thank you for that question. That, see, this is a problem in I would say that this is actually a difficulty in Foucault's writings. That, see, you are absolutely clear that, see, in one sense, Foucault says that subject is something which is, it is to be understood as an effect of other of power. Okay, so power produces subjects, but at the same time, I know there is a precondition that it has to, you have to be free first of all. So there can be, you know, one can argue that there is an idea of free will over there. So there is a kind of contradiction in Foucault's writings. You know, maybe this is the point that you wanted to raise, I suppose, isn't it?
I think so. Ansel can clarify this.
Yeah. Is he here?
You can take a look at the chat. The person is there, Ansel. Anyway, I think that's the sense of it. You can go ahead. Yeah.
See, this is a problem in Foucault, actually. You know, this is being pointed out by many Foucault scholars and many critics. Like, you know, how this reconciliation happens in Foucault. That, to my mind, this is a difficulty which has to be resolved, in the sense that Foucault is not, you know, actually, you know, giving a satisfactory kind of answer satisfying kind of response to this problem, at least as far as my reading of Foucault is concerned, that Foucault was, of course, this there is a kind of constructionism in Foucault that I already pointed out, that constructionism in the sense that there is there is no essential kind of subjectivity, or there is nothing called a free will or whatever, but subject is something which is being produced, historically produced, and his interest is to see how this takes place, this activation of subject is it happens, how does it take place, but see, of course, he will have to agree with you or agree with this point that, see, there has to be some kind of minimal condition of, freedom has to be taken as a minimal condition of subjectivity. Like, otherwise, there is power cannot be exercised at all. If, there is a physical thing over there, then it doesn't make any sense to say that I can apply power on it. Because for applying power, for exercising power, you need to presuppose that, this thing which is being, acted upon, should act in such a manner that there should be a kind of either or situation. There should be some kind of, free will. So, so I would say that, that minimal condition for having, agency or whatever, freedom has to be, so this, of course, I would completely agree with you that there is a contradiction here. There is a contradiction in the philosophical analysis. You would find it some difficulty in understanding this position. Okay. Okay, we'll.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I mean, the way you put it, that condition, the minimal condition, which yeah. actually, materializes the notion of power. Otherwise, yeah. there is no resistance, then there is no power, etc. I think that is fair. So, Vidya, you can move ahead.
Yes, thank you, sir. Ms. Prachi has asked, if according to Foucault, power is everywhere, then does it mean that the binaries between oppressor and oppressed is an abstraction and not a reality?
Yeah. Actually, the very binary between the oppressor and the oppressed. Okay. Actually, Foucault's point is that, see, of course, there is some kind of, that understanding of power, we are familiar with, like, oppression, subjugation, and things like that. But see, look at the phenomenon of power, not necessarily involving a kind of repressive kind of, see, to say that power is everywhere in the social field, it means that, see, it has to be, as I have already pointed out, that this is a kind of microphysics of power, that, see, oppression, of course, any kind of subjugation, relation of subjugation, oppression, and other things, see, basically, you have to be placed in a field of power relations, okay? So, at the very basic fundamental level, you had to be, the bodies have to be placed in a situation where there is an exercise of power possible between two bodies. So power has to be taken as a very minimal kind of, minimal in the sense that as a primitive, as a kind of very fundamental kind of property of all social relations. And on the basis of this, you can think about the repression and other kind of, relations, subjugations and things like that. But, for discussing all these things, or for looking at any kind of relations of oppression or whatever, violence and whatever, that a field where these bodies are being placed, okay, or being inscribed, or being enabled to act in a particular manner, in different manners, different ways. No, and it is in this sense that Foucault says that power is everywhere. There is no oppression without a society where there is relation of power. So to think about oppression, you need to think about a field where bodies are being placed in such a manner that each body acts on the action of the other.
Thank you, sir.
Madhu, can I also get a clarification, because the same point sometimes bothers me too. So in other words, it's because it draws a distinction between violence and power. I mean, this oppression, etc., can be seen through the notion of violence. I mean, you are doing a violence to the other. In order for that, there is something more fundamental, which is power. So many a time we equate this violence with power. That is where I think the confusion lies.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you, Koshi. I know that is what I wanted to. Right.
Okay. Thank you.
So it's almost 4, but will it be okay for you to take a couple of questions more?
Yeah.
So in the chat box, there's another question by Mr. Sujit. If power is being equated to freedom and body as being inscribed, then how would Foucault ascertain the possibility of the subject acting as an autonomous individual? Would it imply a great deal of unlearning?
Yeah. Again, another loaded kind of notion that now you have brought in, that individual. See, individual again, Foucault would say that individual, what is an individual? First of all, individual is something which is being individuated, individuation takes place, okay, kind of separation, isolation. A body is being individuated from other body, okay, and it becomes an individual. And there is a sense of individuality. And this sense of individuality, as far as Foucault's kind of analysis is concerned, is something which is inscribed, One cannot become an individual, autonomously, in the sense that the sense of individuality is something which is inscribed on the body, and this inscription is possible only in a situation where, there is a kind of a relation of power, a kind of acting on the action of the other. So individual, Foucault would say that should not be taken as a primitive kind of thing. It is something which is historically produced, or it's something which is discursively produced, or whatever. So bringing in the concept of individual again, will be a problem again in Foucault's, as far as Foucault is concerned. So, analysis, a kind of analyzing a social relation, should not actually begin from the notion of individual. In the debates of in social science, social theory, and all, there is an ontology of relations here. Relations are to be taken as primary. And individual becomes an individual only in a situation of relations where one is acting on the action of the other. So even individual is a product of power, is an effect of power.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, can religion also be considered to have power?
I really did not get the sense of that question, but religion as power means what? What does it mean to say that a religion is religion, or relations between within a religious community? Is it what is meant by the? It's not clear.
The person was raised this question. If you're online, please try to clarify it, or we'll move to the next question in the meantime.
Yeah.
So the next question is by Ms. Deepa. Is resistance to power also an exercise of power, and enabling is an action on the action of the other to strive to achieve freedom for the marginalized?
The question of marginalization, actually, I have not gone into that aspect of Foucault's notion of power. That, of course, and the first part of the question is that, is resistance also is a kind of power? I would say that it is right. The question has got a point, that resisting means what? You are resisting something, okay? Means, there has to be some amount of power, okay? And within a relation of power, there is resistance possible. So there is a mutuality, there is a mutual implication, or resistance means there is a possibility of power, and power implies a kind of resistance. Without the resistance, there cannot be anything called power. The second part, could you explain it? student is here, our scholar is here.
Ms. Deepa, are you here? Would you like to explain the second part of the question? You can raise your hand or explain it in the chat box. So in the meantime, can we take the next question?
Yeah.
Okay. So Mr. Amit has three questions. The first one is, has Foucault made any distinction between oppression, repression, and power?
I know distinction in the sense that any kind of relation, okay, including the relation between the oppressor and the oppressed, is a relation of power. Okay, see, at this level, there cannot be any distinction between these two. Okay, because there is no oppression without power. Okay, and including the relation between the oppressor and the oppressed, okay, implies power. Okay. But the thing is that it should not be reduced to that. Now, the notion of power should not be reduced to the notion of oppression. That power is something, okay, which has to be understood as something, you know, everywhere, in the sense that the kind of, I know what you call horizontality of the relations between A and B, that are different bodies distributed in a social field, means that, it could be, okay, from everywhere. Not necessarily from the upper strata, the state or government or whatever. So this is the point that Foucault wanted to put forward with regard to the notion of power.
All right. The second question is, how would one respond to the feminist critique that women have been oppressed or repressed throughout history by men from Foucault's notion of power? Because Foucault says that, I find the notion of repression inadequate and insufficient amount of power relation, because power should be understood as productive and in a more positive way.
The question whether it is negative or positive is, Foucault would say that, nothing is good or bad, but everything is dangerous. You know, this is one of his, argument, one of his statements made by Foucault. Let's see, whether power is negative or positive, or whether this is good or bad, is not the question. But the thing is that everything is negative. There is a kind of pessimistic kind of attitude, approach towards the notion of power in Foucault. But the thing is that, feminist critics, also feminist theory, maybe one of the points, basic points that feminist theory has appropriated or taken from Foucault, especially in Butler, okay, Foucault inspired kind of feminist theory, I think it was like Butler, that the most important point that is being taken from Foucault is the distinction between the sex and gender, okay, or the way Foucault has actually dismantled the very distinction which is being propagated or which is being maintained throughout the history of feminist theory, especially from Simone de Beauvoir onwards, that there is a distinction between culture and the biological. Sex is something biological and gender is something cultural. So this is the point that Foucault, this is in this sense that Foucault becomes useful for feminist theory, that understanding power in this manner, that as something all pervasive or something which is everywhere, not necessarily as repression. I know this gives a new kind of conceptual tool for feminists to understand patriarchy or any other, like male domination and things like that. So we need to have a kind of what you call different kind of strategy to deal with the situation, the patriarchal system or whatever, any system for that matter. This is a way Foucault becomes useful for feminist theory, I suppose.
So we have some more questions in the chat box. It's past 4, but would you like to take them?
Okay, it's already 4. 4 now?
Yes, not if you're...
Yeah, proceed, yes. No, yeah. At least I'll get, yeah.
Koshi sir, should we continue taking the questions?
Yeah, another 5 minutes perhaps. How many more are there in the chat? You can select.
Okay. All right. The next question is by Cinderella. If there is a voluntary relinquishment of freedom, then how do the power dynamics change between A and B?
How do we change the power dynamics between A and B?
If there is a voluntary relinquishment of freedom.
Voluntary relinquishment of freedom means what? You know?
So Cinderella says that if one party gives up their freedom.
Can you do that? You know, giving up freedom means what? You know, again you are free. It is because of the fact that there is an option, there is a kind of choice, either or, that you can say that I don't need freedom. So a voluntary relinquishment of freedom means what? You know, it presupposes freedom, some amount of freedom.
Actually, Cinderella, if you look at the way you have worded it, voluntarily itself implies no freedom. If you voluntarily give up freedom.
Yeah.
So it's like, I think the Sartrean notion, not to choose is itself is an act of choice.
Exactly.
So what I mean is that if I decide that henceforth I choose, like I sign a particular contract, or by virtue of being, say, a citizen of a particular place, I have to give up my freedom. I do not really have a choice, but by virtue of being a citizen of that place, or you know, entering a particular relationship, etc., I decide to voluntarily give up my freedom. And then what happens to the power dynamics post that? Because if power is about having freedom, then how does the power dynamics change? Is there a power dynamics after that? After, you know, one party has given up their freedom? I think, that's my question.
Thank you. But the question here is that, is it a condition where your freedom is being suspended, or is it a voluntary kind of relinquishment of freedom, which is a problematic kind of thing? That, you know, a kind of suspension of freedom, as Professor Koshi was pointing out, that Sartre's case of, you know, what you call bad faith, where, you know, you are free, but the freedom is being suspended at a particular moment, as a point where, you know, your decision is not being communicated. You know, in the sense that, see, my body, or a part of my body becomes paralyzed, okay? Where, you know, I have a decision, you know, to move my body, well, that particular part of my body, but the decision is not being communicated to that part of your body. Is it a situation where your freedom is being suspended, or is it that you are giving up your freedom to do that?
Sir, I think what I'm talking about when I say voluntary, I mean you are giving it up voluntarily, but there is also an element of not really choicelessness. I mean, you can choose to not give it up and then face the consequences, but you do not want to face those consequences, and so you give up your freedom. And so in that sense, there is choice, but there is also choicelessness. So after that, what happens to the power dynamics between A and B? Is it, in Foucauldian terms, would it still be where there is no power, or would it, I mean, we can't call it power at all, or would it be that, okay, fine, since you have given it up voluntarily, you had a choice, and so the power dynamics continue, or whatever is happening according to your choice?
I think we'll have to think of it, but the thing is that, see, you know, if it is a situation where, you know, still there is an either or. Either I can or not. Okay. Then, you know, there is freedom. Is it the case that, see, you know, if it is a matter of choice, then there is freedom. Okay. Then if there is no possibility of either or, Okay, suppose a situation where you are not, you know, having this kind of either or kind of situation, then it is, you know, freedom doesn't make any sense to say, it doesn't make any sense to say that power is there in such a field where a particular body is having no choice, you know, no freedom, no either or. Then, you know, Foucault would say that, you know, power, it absolutely doesn't make any sense to say that there is power between, you know, these two bodies interacting each other. In fact, there is no interaction at all. There's a kind of subject-object kind of relation there.
Yes, okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for
that. Yeah, well, okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sintrana. I think, well, there are some more questions, but because of the paucity of time, we can't take them up. You could probably all mail Professor Madhu. And thank you, Professor Madhu, for answering all the questions. And thank you, everyone, for posing the questions. Over to you, Vasudha.
Yeah. Thanks, Vidya, Vasudha, for conducting this session. Let me thank all of you being present here for this talk. It was a wonderful session. And thank you, Madhu, for your time and the way you have addressed each and every question in detail. Thanks a lot. I just want to draw your attention that during the talk, there were many of our common friends I could see, but some of them have left. Still, I can see Professor Lenka from Hyderabad University, Dr. Mohammad Ali from Hyderabad.
I could see Mohammad Ali.
I could also see earlier Professor Shivan from Silchar.
Shivan also I could see.
And Professor Hari is there, physics. So there were many of our contemporaries from Hyderabad and Professor Lenka, you want to speak something about power? You please, yes.
Lenka, I enjoyed your lecture so much, Madhu. I really liked it, and I find that I have no question in the sense that actually many of the things, the way that I understand, I agree with you first on all the points. So in that respect, I don't have promotion to ask, in fact.
Okay. Thank you so much, Lenka. After a long time, very long time, I have
been thinking. In fact, I appreciated the way that you presented, in the sense that it was quite clear. It was actually reflecting your clear understanding of the thing. Okay. So I thank you very much. Because we have another parallel seminar in the department. That is why some of the students do not have attended. Of course, we did have this paper for postmodernism also in our course. So many could have enjoyed your lecture. Some of the students will say one or two questions raised to us actually from my student Amit.
There's some problem with the audio, I suppose. I'm not really.
Okay, nice. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Lenka. Thank you. Dr. Ali. Dr. Ali also perhaps wants to say something. Dr. Mohammad Ali.
Hi, Ali. Unmute.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can.
I thought, by mistake, thought it would start at 4. But I rated here at 3:30.
That's typically Ali's confusion, I understand.
But it was a good talk. Whatever I heard was interesting. Thank you.
Thank you, Ali. Thank you for being there. And many others were there, Shrijit and So let me now request the organizers, Vasudha, Vidya, to go ahead.
So I'll just request Liz to please give the vote of thanks. Elizabeth.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, we can hear you.
Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Department of Philosophy, I'm here to present the vote of thanks for today's lecture. Firstly, I would like to express my gratitude to our distinguished speaker, Dr. Madhu, for taking time out of his schedule to be with us. Sir, really, the way you have lucidly explained the notions of subject, body, and path through the Foucauldian lens, and then talking about the interlinkages of the three, and carefully elucidating the concept, the notion of how power is exercised, then going down to understanding subject and body was especially very engaging. Thank you, sir, so much for your philosophical insights. I would like to thank Professor Koshi, Head of Department of Philosophy, all faculty members of department and research scholars for organizing and supporting this lecture. For those who contributed towards the designing of this very attractive poster, great work, thank you. A word of gratitude for all research scholars for spreading the word, especially about the lecture event. And finally, to our keen attendees, without whom the webinar would not be well received. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. More power to you. Over to you, Vasudha.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you, Vasudha. Thank you, Vidya. Thank you all, everybody. Thank you, Madhu, for that.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Madhu.
Thank you for your questions, for your patient listening. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Okay, bye.